think that was like a beautiful thing to experience.
I think it's really cool that you talk about embracing blackness, and I've thought to myself about how personally, like, I grew up in an environment where I was very much sort of encouraged by my parents to assimilate. You know, it wasn't even integration, it was to assimilate, to do. My parents always told us, we're gonna go back, okay? That's for sure. We're not staying for very long. There's gonna be peace in Burundi and we will go back. But for now, do like they do, speak like they do, you know, get the degree, you know, go to school and just assimilate. And I remember also, like, back home, because there was this constant sense of, like, we're gonna go back, don't worry. Also, the stories of all the but we did speak Kirundi, but, like, that was as much as it went in terms of transmission of cultural identity, right? And so I sort of started really, sort of growing up in the sense that I had to be basically as white as possible. So my friends were all white. I became quite proud of that. And the last 3-4 years being involved in anti-racism has really taught me what it means to, like, look inside and to also, well, also definitely look outside, but to pursue embracing my blackness and embracing my African identity, both in African terms, continental terms, but also in European terms. And it's been quite a journey. And I think, I love this idea of embracing blackness, because I think in the word embracing, there's connotations of tenderness, of love, of generosity even. And so I want to look at blackness and Africanness as something that we can take care of and that we can sort of grow lovingly, and not some sort of burden or something, but like as something that we can embrace truly. And that's a process that has been really interesting. And I think in embracing that, it also comes with what you described in your piece about how at some point, like, we're that hypervisibility as creatives means that whatever we do is representative of blackness, mm-hmm. right? And it's being measured according to this sort of, like, are you urban or not? You know, like, so whatever we do as black creatives, it has that, and so I find myself sort of struggling with how do I embrace my blackness, but at the same time, how do I fight for the room and the space to not be burdened with this sort of this stereotype, this framework, this frame of, like, this is a black artist, you know? But it'd be like, a black artist.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, to me it's also, like, it's hard because it's a big responsibility to, like, you know, operate as an ambassador of, like, the whole black community, and also in its multitudes and its nuances. It's, like, really hard, and you can't be that, like, we can't be ambassadors of that. And I do realize that, like, for other non-black creators or non-creators of color, more specifically, there's a lot more of individuality. I think that as a creative of color or as a black creative, you first have to wrestle with the collectiveness of your work before you can engage with the individuality of it.
Because you write for Vogue now, you're a columnist for Vogue. So how does that work? How do you?
Well, it's been going quite well, actually. But it's definitely something that you keep in mind, like writing for like bigger publication, for majority white media, it's something that you keep in mind. Like, you're thinking about who is reading this, who is my audience, who reads me, and the people that read you also can influence the way you're gonna write things, because there's a lot of conversations that I want to have, but then I also have to think about whether that conversation is an inside conversation, like a communitary conversation, or like a public conversation, just as much as I can have a conversation that I only have with my mom, or a conversation that I can have with my mom and all my friends are there. So there's definitely, there's definitely things, and also there's shifts in that. I see a little bit of shift in that. Like, I see the way in which as subjects can maybe kind of like transcend that space where they have to be kept secret or be protected from the outside world. I take, for example, the issue of sexuality amongst women of color, black women, black trans women. It's like the urgency of protecting our bodies, like
Twitter, and you're part of Black Dutch Twitter, or is it Black European Twitter? I don't know.
I think
just so. Black Twitter. Yeah,
Black Twitter.
All of it, all of it.
Black Twitter.
Black Twitter,
yeah.
Yes.
And it's definitely not only Black Dutch Twitter, because I identify a lot with like Black French Twitter.
Okay.
Also.
You really?
Yeah, but there's a certain alienation, right? Because I'm not geographically like placed there as much.
Yeah.
But it still feels like, and I don't know if we can like show the video that we're talking about, but it still feels like there's this part of me like that doesn't get like to be shown in these spaces, in the Netherlands, and in Belgium. I do have that. Belgium is trilingual, Francophone, Dutch, Germanophone, like Brussels with a lot of African people and people of color. So I feel that like I have a lot of more space to explore all those parts of mine. And because like I think that the process of, because I talk about this also in my TED Talk, like what
does
it mean?
She did a TED Talk too, really great. Look it up. Look it up. We should put it as a link in the...
Like what does it mean to becoming Afro-European, right? And then I asked the question, like, am I rootless or am I free? And yeah, you'll find the answer to that in the TED Talk. But so the question is, like, do you not have roots, or does being of multiple places mean that you're free? That's a hard question. That's an interesting question. And I don't know, like, yeah, this is what I was going to say. If, when I look at, so arriving in the Netherlands at 5 years old, being, your life is politicized, like, from the beginning of your life is politicized. It's that way for a lot of African kids, but especially if you're also a political refugee, and what that means, and, like, what it means to flee your country, to arrive in the Asylum Psychiatry Center. So you do this whole process, and a lot of the memories that I have are in multiple different languages.
Mm-hmm.
So if I think about my first years of life, then my memories are in French.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel other emotions when I talk French, like my mind taps into that side of my being. And of course, like there's a sense of like missing that part when you're not tapping into that that memory. And I have the same with Dutch, like it's different, and with Dutch, I have that in the sense that I come from the south of the Netherlands, Brabant, Eindhoven, the Gekste. When I'm in Amsterdam, the kind of Dutch that people speak here, it doesn't tap into my emotions.
Okay.
Like it's not like it's very
distant,
surreal.
Yeah.
and like it's very distant to me, like it's not personal, like, but when I'm in the south of the Netherlands, the accent, it's so close to home, like it brings, it makes me automatically tap into other emotions, not necessarily always positive ones.
I'm listening to you speak, and I get this very strong sense that you, interesting, you started this sort of, you were talking about, are you rootless, you know, or are you free? And I'm hearing you speak about just these different associations that you have with language already, and I get the sense that you are extremely rooted. Your roots seem just a little bit way more spread out than others, but I think that's really interesting that you have, that you can really sort of have a sense of historicity and personal historicity from just hearing the language. That's, I think that's pretty rooted in my book.
We'll find in the TED Talk what the answer is. Though.
I also think what your TED Talk is amazing, because I think it's really awesome how you place that your roots, you look for your roots and you place it within a lineage, a matrilineal lineage. And I think it's really interesting how generous you are, because you don't just go through your mother, but you look bigger and you sort of put all these women of color, these black women from all these different diasporic communities and shiros. And I'm listening to you speak, I'm like, whoa, like I've actually started doing that a little bit as well, like expanding my sense of lineage and ancestry to much bigger, to being like, I can also put in all the queer ancestors out there from your background. But anyways, but that's a different point. I think it's, I'm completely forgetting what I was supposed to talk to, because you made a really great point about, are we free as sort of people who have lived in between different cultures and communities? That's a question that I feel like sometimes haunts me. Because I find myself, also as a trans person, I find myself constantly at intersections and at borders of things.
Yeah.
And as a person who's lived, I've lived actually like on 4 different continents by now. And at this point, I don't even know culturally what to say I belong to anymore. Like, I've been inspired by Chinese culture, I've been inspired by, you know, Randese, Burundian culture, which are similar but not entirely. I've been inspired by American, French, and sometimes I get lost in that, and I'm like, am I just sort of free-floating or something? And
the hard part, I think, with living at intersections, in Dutch you have this word, vogelvrij, and there's a difference between being vrij and being vogelvrij, which to me, vogelvrij is like, translates to English, free like a bird, but it's not really what it means in Dutch, right? In Dutch it means like you're free to be attacked by anyone. And that's a very scary feeling too. So there's not only this this element of being free, there's also this element of having like being able to be exposed to a lot of different layers of danger. Like,
true. That's true, now you're scaring me. But because I had, in the last year or so, I'd come to the conclusion, one of the things that inspired me has been finding out that a lot of like pre-colonial societies and civilizations deemed queer people and trans people as some sort of intermediaries between the spiritual world and the tangible world, the material world. And because they were seen as standing in between these different sort of identities, binary identities, and they were sort of it was intimated that because they are like at borders, that they might actually have a much larger connection to seen and unseen things, but they were also seen as healers but also as messengers. And when I see how my relationships have developed with the different communities I've been in, I really notice that if you embrace that sort of I wouldn't call it unrootedness but multi-rootedness, if you embrace it, you really end up sort of in a cycle of in a relationship of messaging, of showing people what they don't see about themselves.
Yes.
And I'm very inspired by that. And when I think of that as, and I think it definitely does require more protection, because in the old traditions of magic and ritual religions, you know, the person who was the intermediary also was covered in amulets of protection, right? So indeed, I think we do need more protection. We are more at risk, but there is definitely something beautiful and inspiring about being at these intersections. And I'm really looking for ways to authentically, but also responsibly, sort of engage these different communities I'm part of, right? Mm-hmm. So I see, now we're going off completely on tangent, but I see, for example, in the LGBT community in Burundi, I found myself really noticing at some point that what I had to say was also very European.
Yeah.
And I found myself having to be careful, like, how do these identities constructed in Europe by queer theorists or whatever, like, do they work for the Burundian, for Burundian gender and sexual diverse people? And I had to learn how to listen to them, but also perhaps I found myself being sort of seen by them as an example of how it could be. And I like that sense of like inspiring, but I also felt like I need to be very careful and responsible with how I play that in-between role or something. We talked about it a little bit on the phone, and that's one of those conversations that are also very hard to have outside of the community, right? About how do we sort of engage the situation back home as diasporic people? How do we responsibly sort of participate in the political debate and discourse back home? I know this is a difficult one to talk about, but I thought maybe you had some ideas.
Well, I think we should engage without sort of trying to kind of like lead the way. Because it would be funny, right, if we try to like lead the way back home when they're the ones that are home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And to me, it's like, it would be dangerous to engage in the formal way, so to by leading the way, because it's like you're entering a I don't know, like it reminds me of like when you return to your like parents' home, right? Your mm-hmm. parental home, and then like if you'd like start moving around furniture, like, and in a way that they don't really like, you know, want to sit, or like it's their home, right? And they've been cultivating that for a particular time, and then you just arrive, and then like there was this thing that I was thinking about two days ago, which is decolonizing is a product of colonization too. Which means that
that's intense.
And that would mean that like even within decolonizing is still looking through like a lens of Western trauma, right?
Yeah.
And like I don't think that our solution should come from a space of trauma.
No.
And I see that sometimes in how we engage with the continent, with the African continent, but also like, you know, whichever place you call home, that we should engage with it without forgetting that we carry that lens of trauma, and that like if we're gonna engage, it's gonna be from a space of trauma. It reminds me of Killmonger from Black Panther.
Are you gonna spoil it right now? Actually, I haven't seen it, but I don't mind spoilers. But are there people who haven't seen it yet and who do really care about spoilers? No, no one. Okay, no. Maybe people online, they don't wanna. I heard something happened to Killmonger.
Yeah, no, I can't tell you, but what it does remind me is it's like, you know, engaging with the continent from a space of trauma.
Yeah.
And, like, you know, hurt people.
Yeah.
So it's like, I think that we can engage, but like you said, we should take a backseat. And also, like, that realization of, like, I don't know, decolonization being a product of a colonial product too. That's like intense, and that's I'm still trying to figure out what
that's
to do with
one.
That.
That's a big one. I feel like I also need one. We're gonna have to have this conversation tomorrow. about the people, hurt people hurt people. That's also another one which to me has also been like I see anti-blackness in POC communities that I want to connect with, that I feel that we have a vested interest in creating ties, creating connections and developing strategies together, and you know, sort of working together towards that decolonization of the patriarchal, imperialist, racist, capitalist project that we're all in on the European continent as well. Which is also, for me, is also a hard realization too. So when you realize that we're trying to decolonize in the home of the imperialist, it's a bit, because the decolonization as a concept came from people trying to, you know, get rid of the colonizer in the colonies, right, in their home, and we're in the heart of the Belly Beast, and we're proposing to bring the decolonization process home, right, and but I think we need from different angles we need those interventions, but I have a hard time sort of figuring out what to do because you know I'm just like so there's this concept of political blackness, and which would mean. Well, can you explain a little bit what that means exactly?
Well,
I'm terrible with definitions. So.
Well, I couldn't like necessarily give the definition,
okay.
But I could like try to explain how it plays out in on the European continent, more specifically in the Netherlands and in the UK. And I think that it's a reflection of not looking at the American narratives too much and forgetting what our own geographic realities are. So political blackness, how it plays out in the Netherlands is that any person that is not politically black, politically white, automatically becomes politically black.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I also say politically white because of whiteness also being a construct, and because it matters if you're white and poor or white and rich, white and educated or not, etc. And then political blackness in the Netherlands is what we know by allochtone, which is like pulling all these different groups together in one.
Mm-hmm.
Which could create a very interesting like narrative of solidarity as a result, but where it fails is that it like kind of in a natural way fails black people, and the reason why I think it has failed black people is that within our communities of color and black communities, we still haven't finish this conversation around anti-blackness, which is an ongoing conversation. You can't really finish that conversation, but that to me is why it has failed black people. It's this thing where, for example, you'll have an institution that organizes, for example, Martin Luther King Day, but then doesn't invite black speakers, and like that is a what you see happening there is that it's not like we shouldn't have this conversation with non-black people. Of course, like we're building solidarity and ties, but within that, why is the reason why the whole movement started with Martin Luther King, not all movement, but specifically with Martin Luther King, why are those people that look like him that face that specific kind of exclusion, why are they being erased? Because it's the conversation doesn't even evolve around which exclusion or which marginalization is worse than the other. It's more of like, what are we specifically talking about, right?
Yeah.
And it's hard if you don't get the chance to talk about the specific pain you're in, you won't get the specific medicine for it. So it's kind of like very logic. But in a way, you see that in the Netherlands, like, because I was having this conversation right on Twitter, and like some people were saying like this doesn't exist, like a political plex. I was like, what does autochtone mean? What does it mean?
Yeah.
It like that's like the whole concept of it. It's like non-white. That's what it means. But non-white is not an explanation for all the different multitude of realities and lives that we're living, and. And I think it's a necessary conversation because I want us to be invested in each other more than invested in deconstructing whiteness. I want us to be invested in reconstructing us more than deconstructing whiteness, and because I think that's. That is, there's a lot more work being, like, not maybe not more, but more complex.
Yeah.
More complex.
I'm going to steal this one from you, you know that. I love this. So, like, not
because we talk a lot about deconstruction,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
But who talks about reconstruction?
No, this is the first time I've ever heard of this, so need to elaborate.
So, yeah, I think that we should, because non-Muslim people of color, non-Muslim black people to be more invested in what it means to tackle Islamophobia.
Yeah.
I want us to do that work, you know. I want us to do the work. So, like, people think when you talk about, like, the problem of political blackness, they think, like, oh, you're just trying, like, to make it all about you. No, political blackness also means that we don't get to talk about all the different, like, it's not about only, like, anti-blackness.
Yeah.
Right. It's about being invested in each other more than being invested in deconstructing whiteness. Yeah.
I really like this idea of creating spaces where we may think first of like deconstructing or decolonizing or sort of combating whiteness, but end up also really invested in one another and reconstruct. I love this. This is real work that I think could be very inspiring and also could elicit also a lot more theory and a lot more strategies and a lot more. This is really cool.
Yeah, because I also think why reconstructing is because, like you said, we're in the belly of the beast in a way, and like we're not gonna engage in that way from a space of trauma with the homeland that we have. So we're gonna have to reconstruct. Where we geographically are.
How do you place this within the context of this? Because you say the African identity is a strategic, is a strategy, right? How do you place this reconstruction within this African identity?
So being invested more in each other also means that we learn about the different realities of the nation states that we're in. So you have, like, for example, I live in Brussels, so I grew up in Eindhoven, but I live in Brussels, as I explained, like, my choice for Brussels comes from a space where, you know, they're Francophone, they're trilingual, and it's more tickling to the brain, I guess, to live there.
I think she just called it a little boring. We're gonna write that down. I'm very offended right now.
Well, I didn't say the Netherlands, though. Not the Netherlands. Because I don't necessarily like identify also with all the Netherlands thing. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm Black Brabants.
Yeah. Okay.
Like, so that's like a specific. Like, you know, I'm not Amsterdam right now.
Yeah.
You know, so like.
I think people in the Randstad should hear that more often. That people outside of the Randstad go like...
Yeah, because like I moved to Belgium, right? I moved to Belgium and the first thing they say to me is like, you're a Hollander. I'm like, I've never been called a Hollander in my life.
I had the same thing in Maastricht though. Eh? I've studied in Maastricht for 3 years, and also there I was called a hula.
Yeah, but like.
So I don't know what the Maastrichtenaars think where they are at. So.
I think the Maastrichtenaars are confused.
Like, there's a lot of shade here.
They're lost in the salt and the sauce.
Okay, no,
but
go on.
They might have been confused, but also in a way, like, of course, like, you, like, in a way, they're gonna think of you as a Hollander, but I think that from Maastrichtenaars and from people from Brabant, it's another kind of way. Because, like, when Flemish people call me Hollander, they think that the Netherlands is Holland. They don't even, like, they never got the memo that Holland is a province.
Yeah.
The memo never arrived. So that's, like, interesting to me because I found myself in a space where I had to defend my Dutch identity, and I didn't even, like, I don't even care, but now I do have to care because obviously you don't know what the country that I, you know, am rooted in is about, so now I have to, you know, educate this. So yeah, it was interesting, like, moving to Belgium forced me to engage with my Dutchness because I realized that I am Dutch, yes, I'm direct, yes, it's true. You know, like, sometimes I think Belgian people are slow, yeah, true. You know, it's like, what's that? No, but
it you're not making any friends with us.
No, but I have a lot,
I have
a lot of Belgian friends.
Okay.
No, but,
but it also got you invested in other sort of African or black identities and experiences in Belgium, in France, you said.
Yeah.
So if I understand correctly, you're saying we need to get more invested in the black experience.
Yes, so we were talking about each other's realities, right? Oh yeah, and when I say Belgian slow, I don't mean like people of color. getting invested in each other's realities. So you have all these nation states, and they all have like their specific histories with colonialism, or with also battling in a way colonialism also. Because I've thought about this before, right? Why in the Netherlands, when I was integrating in the Netherlands, I feel like integrating in Dutch means has such another.
Yeah.
I don't know, like integreren. It's like ta-da-dam. But integreren is like integreren. But anyway, integreren. It's like when I was integrating. So you have to learn the language, and you're at school, and everything is like kind of like perfect in this perfect new country, or at least not necessarily perfect in a happy way, because it was more of like a too porcelain cast what is happening here.
But happy as in being a kid and being also sometimes a bit clueless.
Yes. And so you're integrating. And what I was trying to say is that you're learning about all the Dutch heroes.
Heroes.
No, but there's multiple thoughts coming up in my mind. Like, heroes. Wait, like, I feel like in the culture, the Rwandese culture as I know it, we're not so obsessed about heroism.
That's true.
The stories that you tell at bedtime, it's like, do you know the story of Georges Vanetti?
No.
Georges Vanetti, like, because Rwandese people don't know how to say George.
Georges
Vanetti, it's like this awkward, like, kind of like awkward kid that does like his mom said go close the door George and he came back with the door in his hand.
Okay.
It's like that kind of bedtime stories. It's not about the big heroes, it's about the funny clumsy people in the community.
Yeah.
So So that was the thing that popped up in my mind, like, why are we so obsessed with heroism
in
the West?
I think that's a really good question to ask. I think also with Irk, have you heard about the Khmer?
Yes.
Irk deciding to, that's very problematic. Yeah. Also, especially, you saw that with the American South, in the 20s, they had a revival of all these statues of Confederate officers and generals and whatnot. And you have now in Urk, in the Netherlands, having this revival, they decided they're going to name all these streets and the monuments, I think, as well, to like sea pirates and captains who did and who were either heavily involved in slavery or in plantations around the world, or in the colonization of Indonesia and Suriname. And right now, at this moment, when so many voices of these communities, colonized communities, that migration background, are putting on the pressure and really sort of speaking out, this is the moment when they really feel the need to hold on to these mythical figures.
Yeah.
They're sort of cleanly washed.
Yeah.
And
yeah, I think that comes from the fact that we don't, here in the Netherlands at school, we don't learn to engage with shame, with the emotion of shame.
Yeah. And responsibility.
Responsibility and shame. So, but I think responsibility is kind of like not an emotion.
Okay.
Like, I feel like taking responsibility is can be a result of of embracing the emotion of shame.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't take responsibility unless you feel ashamed by what has happened.
Yeah. But the way the sort of protecting the children from shame mentality, right?
Yes.
We don't want the children to know.
Yeah.
That the historically,
yeah.
Our nation state is a project that is built on blood, bones, and theft and rape, and this mentality that we gotta protect the children from it, so we never cannot have it in our books. I think it betrays. I think it's that white innocence and this contract of keep on creating this sort of this walls and this barricade towards engaging authentically with their history, with our shared history.
Exactly. That's what I mean by, you know, not being able to engage with shame will always force you to rewrite that history in a way that obsesses about like heroism.
Mm. Good one. I think also both the countries where we come from.
Yes,
that was
like my said, like, wait, we don't know how to engage with shame in a way either.
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think I've tried, and I can only speak for the Burundian experience. I feel like oftentimes oppression is not, like, I think of oppression as modular, but not also very creative. I think it has this sort of standard blueprint of methods and formulas of keeping itself going.
Yeah.
But so it's modular, so it can be assembled, the semblance could be different for particular dynamics of oppression and of oppressor and privilege and marginalization, but essentially it always comes down to the same sort of tools. And I've seen in Burundi also this sort of erasure of history to really sort of make sure that the oppression that was done, the violence that comes from it and that keeps on going, the marginalization is sort of obfuscated and made almost natural, almost seems like this is what it's supposed to be like. I was talking to someone today about what I've discovered about sort of about what happened before sort of the colonial the Germans first and then the Belgians and the French and all that, you know, in terms of racializing the ethnic social structures. Into the racialization by the Europeans, yes, was problematic, but there's a history before that. And there's a history of feudality. There's a history of, I wouldn't necessarily call it serfdom, but there was definitely relationships that were definitely oppressive.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you had, between the different ethnicities, I'm talking about the Hutu, Tutsi, Ganwa, and Twas, you had certain mobility things, but just like here, we can't say that everyone can become a CEO and a multi-billionaire. It is possible, but yeah. Not gonna be.
Yeah.
So you could, technically speaking, become Tutsi or Ganwa, whatever, But that wasn't necessarily something, and by racializing it, it became ostracized, it became sort of systems, and that's a problem. But at the same time, I see people in Burundi pick up those notions, those racial theories about the superiority of Tutsis, of Hutus. I see them pick them up and make them in just maybe like 30 years of colonialism in Burundi, 30, 40 years of colonialism, that became a truth. And a truth that served the interest of an elite that was able to take on this sort of, oh, this theory, like, oh, we're actually not, we're other kinds of Africans than you. We come from Egypt. Even theories about, like, oh, we come from Israel.
Now.
Yeah. And they use these same theories to, like sort of, oh, and it erases that history.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I see the same people.
You know what I think why that also is? Our cultures are very they are cultures of like how do you say that, orators, like our histories are told, not written or read, and so the more you tell the same story, the more it becomes
the truth.
I can't go back and go read, like, you know?
Yeah, that's true.
And that's, like, so hard.
You would have to find some old people.
Yeah, you actually have to go and look for an old person and talk to them.
Yeah.
And this is also very interesting, is that I've come also to realize that, you know how, culturally speaking, older people were supposed to be, like, the wise ones and the ones taken very seriously? Haven't you noticed that lately they're the ones that are picked on?
Yeah.
Like, don't listen to grandma.
Yeah.
She's crazy.
Yeah,
I agree. That's interesting. Right?
But I think it has to do, we're completely off course. I think it's really interesting because I've noticed the same sort of when I was in Burundi, and I would see in the rural areas the way that older people were stigmatized for not having a formal, essentially westernized education. That made everything that they knew, everything that they sort of knew about the land, knew about social and cultural norms, knew about law, knew about the world and religion, spirituality, all of that was slowly, I saw it happening before my eyes, how it becomes invalidated.
Yeah.
And so that transference, like no one is going to talk to these old people.
Yeah, and when I was visiting my grandmother, she couldn't see me, right? I was like, why don't you buy her glasses? You know, the Western kid that I was.
Yeah.
They were all laughing at me. Like, what do you mean by glasses for an old woman? Like,
oh, wow.
Like, that was, you know, I was like shocked. Like, okay. But then I also realized, you know, that's my Western lens, right? Because here we're like, you know, keep them alive, operate another time, you know, glasses, teeth, like, keep everything, you know, intact. And like, she was kind of like aging gracefully, and she didn't care that she couldn't see me. She just cared that I was there, she could hug me. And she was like waving into the video camera thinking that it was live.
Okay.
So, she told me, like, why, like, I can't see you, but I can feel you're crying. Why are you crying? Aren't you happy to see me? So, like, this different way of engaging with emotion also. Even though we're, like, kind of deflecting from the conversation that you were trying to have, I think that this brings us to the point why political blackness robs us of so many of these conversations and these stories is... Yeah, because we're only talking about how we kind of, as a people, how we can oppose ourselves or like in position ourselves in front of whiteness, in front of Westernness, and not necessarily within our communities. And like these are the conversations that we're missing from that. So, also to come back to your point about nation states, being Rwandan, being Burundian, in the Netherlands is so overlooked that we don't have to get these conversations. That being Francophone, which we also both are, when you really look at the geographic realities, and that is also what to me being politically Afro-Vietnamese is, that when you invest in each other's geographic realities, you now can become this political entity of a people that can actually have its weight in the democratic procedures, in like a collective voice on the continent. Because you know, when I was working as a youth representative, I used to the G24 Girls, and I used to also go to Strasbourg and stuff like that. Because that was like
Googled you actually.
There's
a bit.
Yeah, but that's not necessarily things that you kind of like. I don't know, like I was also young.
How old are you now?
24.
You're 24 years old. We've been listening to a 24-year-old this whole time. You're a child. Go on.
So, it's my grandmother speaking.
Yeah.
she can see clear now, though. But with...
Oh, that's beautiful. I'm making me cry. But go on.
But when I went to Strasbourg, and it was the European Youth Event, and it was this event that had to bring home like all these different young people from all over Europe, and we would talk about what it means to be European, and basically what that was. It also was like pre-Brexit. Okay. This was pre-Brexit.
Okay.
So what's interesting is that they were kind of like already seeing what was happening, and what was happening was that the European identity was endangered. But what they didn't know is that it had never existed.
You're not making a lot of friends. But
as people on the European continent, we identify with our nation states and with our regions, not as Europeans. And that's interesting because when I was living in Egypt for a summer, it would be like black people, black Egyptians, Nubian people would be like, "Hey, Sudan, Senegal," like in the street, like "Sister, call me sister." Like there's this collective Africanness that we don't have in Europe.
Yeah,
and I'm not sure yet why that historically why that is. I just like realized that it isn't there. And I think that's an interesting thing, like why do Africans like give each other nods in the streets wherever they are in the world?
Yeah.
I don't think white people nod at each other in the streets.
Do they?
What?
Like
that would explain a lot.
Like, I see you.
I think this is really, I just gotta tell you the story. My dad had this way naturalizing any black person that he would see into Burundianness, like really quickly, especially the soccer players. And like he would be watching soccer and then like, "Oh, you jump Burundi, like that Burundian." And he needs to start Burundian. They would all become Burundian. I'm like, and I was very confused when I was there. I was like, "But are they definitely Burundian football players in the world? That can't be." But like, I think that's really interesting. I've seen it also in the African comic when I was in Burundi. This identity, this African identity, people switch in language and speaking.
Yeah.
They go from "I'm Randese" to like, "Oh, and we as Africans." And
that
was really interesting because when I'm here, I find it really sort of a lot of times confronting this sort of identity that I'm given as an African. To me, it's so complicated.
Yeah.
There are many places I've never been in Africa that Africa is humongous, huh?
Yeah.
Like culturally as well, and religiously, and spiritually, and philosophically. Such huge tradition, such diversity in it, and I find myself people talking to me that you're an African, and I'm like, but back home, people do sort of claim that a little bit much easier and with a lot more abandon and carelessness with it than
yeah, but it's also a way of like calling each other home. But I think it's also because, you know, we've only recently started thinking about whiteness as an identity. Whereas Africanness and a lot of other cultures know this notion of Ubuntu. Ubuntu is like the Bantu term, but I know it exists in Arabic. I know it exists in also Turkish. I've forgotten the words for it though. So there's the collectiveness, and then there's like the individuality. So now, like Europeans and Western people, us included as Black Westerns, are now starting to think about what it means, what Westernness could mean as an identity, which also is uncomfortable. You know, I realize that I'm a Black Western person, but I'm not comfortable with that, of course. But I realize like it's important to realize that I am that. I am what I am, what I've become. The point that I was, so I went to Strasbourg, and then they speak Dutch and French, German and French instead of what I knew, Dutch and French, which was really interesting and very like, I don't know, and I ate tarte flambé for the first time. In Strasbourg, they called all these European young people. I was 20, I think, 1920, and we were sitting in the parliament, and all the young people and. I saw like a sea of whiteness, and I was like, I didn't understand like why all these kids seem to be like white, and also because, you know, as a construct, we don't necessarily see people from Poland they're still racialized, but what my eyes could see is that their skin was fair, and then I was like, why is everybody fair skin? And I just like, you know, took the mic and asked the question, why is everybody white? And then, like, I was like, why is it that we're engaging with, we're calling all these young people that are European, but we're not engaging with new Europeans?
And
new Europeans, because like, the European project is a very interesting project, but I feel like we're not realizing that the future of the European project very much depends on new Europeans.
Yeah, I have a lot of. We have to start because it's already an hour, and I feel like I could keep talking to you for like hours, but these people have to go home, I assume. But I just wanted to sort of. I think like the etiquette, the most gracious thing is to let the guests finish, right? No, we should stop here, no? You can have a last word afterwards. But I have a conflict with, and I think I've told you before, but I'm conflicted by this idea of Afropean. And I'll explain why a little bit. My understanding and sort of my analysis, my research with sort of the European project as a civilization and some of these other sort of constructs that are very actively, we're seeing right now actively being construed, like Joods Christelijke, the Jewish Christian sort of tradition, and these things that people are just Judeo-Christian, is that what they call it in English? Yeah. These constructs and whiteness. If I look back in history, I see it very much as being constructed on the backs of Black people, and it being the prerequisite for its establishment of what Europe is and what European civilization means, and now Judeo-Christianism, whatever that's supposed to mean, is very much like exclusionary, like the opposite of what is real and what is worthy, what is human, what is civilized are the Black people, right? And these notions of progressivity, of progressive and liberal notions, philosophically, like you have people like Heidegger, like sort of and Hegel, I believe, construct these elaborate historic philosophical arguments that basically necessitate the black condition to be an animal condition, right? And I find myself in this imperialist sort of civilization, these constructs that have been built on the notion that I am nothing,
mm-hmm.
right? And if I claim my blackness within this project, how is it any other than it being something that dismantles and actually destroys the European project? How can I find a home as a black person, as an African person, in a geographical context, but mostly in a cultural and philosophical context, that necessitates me being nothing?
Yeah.
And if I claim that Afro part of Afropean, doesn't it actually sort of, isn't it a commitment to destroy the European world, to basically say, if it's built on my back, if I shake it off, I'm literally destroying it,
mm-hmm.
right? If I think of it as a body, like if you have an organ, like the European project is basically a body with organs placed, and we have been taken from our homes, from our cultures, and basically utilized as tools, as not even as part of the body, but we've been used as tools. We were property at some point. We were just objects that people could sell, right? Like it was, and we were not even in part of the body. So if I go inside the body, don't I become a foreign element? And what happens to foreign elements in bodies? It kills the body.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think about that, and I'm conflicted, and I'm like, if I embrace blackness and Afroness in a European context, doesn't it actually mean that I am here to disrupt, intervene, and perhaps just destroy? I don't know.
Yeah, no, I get that. I think that historically speaking, the European project is something else than the Western project.
Okay.
Because, you know, with nation states being brought together, and then I feel that a lot of, like, European countries, even now, like Eastern European countries, that they also are like seen as elements from outside the body. So I think that historically speaking, there's a kind of like a difference between like the Europeanness, the Western project, which is what you just described, and then the European project, politically speaking, so like more like strategically speaking, and I don't see it as a claiming, but as recognizing a geographic reality.
Okay.
So to me, it's not like the same. There's like the identity part, so to me there's like the Afro identity part, and there's the geographic reality of Europeanness part.
Okay.
So that would be, but there's something, that's an ongoing conversation, that's something that I also have to think about, because when you first said that, that was like at the podcast here in The Hague, so
yeah. With the Dips House podcast.
Yes, just you can look that up.
Name dropping,
so,
Dips House podcast, the best.
So yeah.
Anusha Zume is coming tomorrow from Dips House podcast.
Yes, she is. So that would be the best, my best way to describe my conclusion to that,
mm-hmm.
at the stage that I'm in, with my thinking.
Good. I'm gonna think of what you're thinking, and I want to thank. I mean, we're exactly on time, I think, or just a little bit over time. I want to thank you for your patience, and I thank you for your generosity, your wisdom, and your superb eloquence, and for taking us on all these different journeys that you're on. And I really hope to read more of your stuff.
Yeah, I actually prepared something for today. Can
you
I read it?
Yes, please. Okay. That would be, because yesterday we finished with a text.
Yeah.
So if you have a text, then we can finish that way. That'd be great. Is that it?
Mm-hmm. So I wrote this last November, and it's called The Paradox of Post-Refugee Life. Last November, during the women's marches and marches against racism in Europe, I realized how much we protest the tyrant in our Western context and how little we know about or protest the tyrants back home. It is that awkward moment when you are a person of color and go out to protest Trump en masse, yet you are too scared, scarred, or silenced to go protest your home country's dictator. He who who is sitting in the lap of your fear, drinking from the fountain of the bloodshed of your people. The sound of his cackle would break your bones and split your teeth in half. That's what he's watching on his television screen, the Trump show. When Audre Lorde said, "We do not live single issue lives," she meant it. And when they asked me who I fear most, the answer is not exclusively Trump. Loosely quoting Nina Simone, how can one be a former refugee and not reflect these political tense times? We have escaped the wars of the world, but the war within has never ceased to wage. And like Ijoma Umebunyo said, there are small inherited wars inside us. Let us fight it now. May we not pass it on to our offspring.
Thank you everyone, go get a drink or something and do fun things with your life.